The 12 core functions of a drug and alcohol counselor are for the agency to ensure that not only are their counselors following specific policies and procedures, but also to ensure that they're doing right by the clients that come in. I'm going to go through each of the 12 core functions. And when I'm doing so, I'm also going to talk about how even with interventionists and calls into intervention offices, there's a lot of similarities in how we have to handle and help families as much as when a substance user calls an agency or a facility. You'll also see a lot of what goes on behind the scenes when they get to a treatment center and how those facilities will address the client when they arrive. So I hope that by the end of this, you'll not only see the importance of hiring a professional, not only for yourself to intervene, but also for your client or for your loved one to go to treatment, but you'll also see a much bigger picture of all that's involved in the drug and alcohol rehabilitation process. So I'm going to go ahead and put the slides up, and I'm going to go through these one by one so you guys can have a better picture as to what it is that's done. So again, the 12 core functions of drug and alcohol counselors is, in other words, it's to help people get what it is that they're looking for. And that first part is very crucial. And that first one is called patient screening. And during the patient screening process, most counselors will follow something called SBIRT, which means screening, brief intervention, and referral to treatment. And really that is a very, very short assessment when a client walks in through the front door of a facility, calls a facility, or even when clients call our office in regards to a loved one. And what you're trying to do is make sure that whatever services you offer at that agency, you have a good idea as to whether or not you can help that client with the services you offer, or if you have to go ahead and refer them out. And when we do ours here at Family First Intervention, at least when families call and give us data on somebody we haven't spoken to, we always have the DSM criteria in the back of our mind, which breaks into severity, into mild, moderate, and severe, along with some other factors such as legal issues, mental health conditions, et cetera. So there's a lot that goes into that first line of questioning. And when we take the calls and families start talking, they can pretty much answer the questions we're looking for if we just, you know, allow them the opportunity to explain the situation. So the second core function is the patient intake. So assuming you get past the screening process for the agency that you'd like to go to, or if that agency has referred you to another one, there's going to be what's called a patient intake. And what happens there is the counselor is required to fill out the documents and examine the technical aspects of admitting the patient. So there's a series of questions, and it's far more in depth than what you got in the screening process. There's a lot of things that are covered, and there's a lot of deeper dive into what it is that they're looking for to make sure that, again, they can help you to their full capabilities at the institution that you're at. It's critical for the counselor to understand the process and guidelines before somebody is fully admitted. So in other words, if somebody does not disclose something on the screening, but they also, but then they then decide to disclose it at the intake portion, that may be something where the agency says, I can't help this client. And then they have to obviously refer out to another agency in collaboration to transfer that client. So assuming that the client makes it through the first two pieces of the 12 core functions, you move on to orientation. So after the screening and the admission or the intake, the patient is then made familiar with the policies, procedures, protocols, curriculum, et cetera, with the agency that they're in. It's very important that this is discussed up front so that the person who's in treatment knows what they're, you know, what they're getting into and what it is that they're going to be doing at that facility or institution. All facilities include regulations about treatment cost, insurance, and client rights. And the counselor must examine each of these aspects to educate the patients that come in to protect themselves and the person. Again, back to assessments, which is the fourth of the 12 core functions, something I want you guys to understand is that assessments never stop. I mean, clinicians and therapists and case managers and counselors are constantly assessing where a patient is at, because their needs and their moods and their behaviors and possible diagnosis of disorders, it all changes from moment to moment. So counselors are constantly assessing strengths and weaknesses and problems that were not disclosed in the first two pieces of the 12 core functions that of course can come up later as people evolve in treatment or go backwards. So again, patient assessment is one of the most vital parts of treatment because it determines the path each patient will take. And what your treatment plan is in the beginning, it may not be what your treatment plan is 2 weeks into your recovery. So the steps of assessment are identifying information and obtaining methods. In other words, the counselor needs to approach each client in the proper manner to make sure that there's an exchange of reliable information. And think about reliable information here. The counselor goes off of what the substance user and or the patient gives them. You know, and that is also the job of a seasoned and well-informed staff to make sure that they are able to pick up on things that they feel may be maybe omitted by the patient, or things that the patient just may not recognize about themselves that the team is able to identify, which can help with ongoing assessment and treatment plans. Gathering information, getting a patient history, includes trauma, alcohol use in the past, mental health, and all other things that may be helpful for the overall treatment plan. And again, it all goes back to reliable information, and it all goes back to the clinical staff and their ability to see things that haven't been discussed. Completing the evaluation, it can be a lengthy process, and it is absolutely necessary to ensure that the clinicians provide the right types of treatment methods in order to ensure a successful outcome. And as I've kind of alluded to in the beginning, it's continuing evaluation. Assessments must be done regularly. They're always happening all the time, just like interventions. Interventions are specific strategies to address specific behaviors to meet a certain goal. And those can happen 15 times in a 30-minute session with a client. So there's always something going on, and there's always several moving parts in a patient assessment. Treatment planning, that all comes from the assessment and the ongoing observation of the client's strengths, weaknesses, growths, or steps backwards. This process takes many, many turns, and there are a lot of different ideas and a lot of specific intervention strategies that are put together to fit and meet the patient's needs. Ongoing treatment planning is different for everybody, and it's very important that the team collaborate and work with one another to understand where that client is at so that they can continue to build a strong treatment plan to ensure that the client leaves better off than when they came. The sixth 12 core of the 12 core functions is counseling. Counseling is part of every good treatment facility. Counseling is basically where you work with the client. In this step, the counselors work to assist patients and families in achieving objectives. Guys, the problem with addiction isn't the drugs or alcohol. The problem with addiction is the behaviors and the experiences and the thoughts and the perceptions behind the drug and alcohol use. Good counseling, good therapy matters. And one thing I learned in my higher education was research showed that the right counselor, in other words, somebody that, you know, meshes well with your loved one, can get farther using wrong strategies than the wrong counselor using the exact strategy your loved one would need. In other words, the relationship with the counselor and the substance user is of the utmost importance. I'm not saying I want a good counselor to give bad information and then have the substance user follow it off the cliff. What I'm saying is that if there's not that bond and that rapport, in other words, if they don't like their counselor, they're not going to listen. And for those of those watching this that immediately default to blaming the counselor for an unsuccessful outcome, stop right there. A lot of addicts and alcoholics, even unbeknownst to this case study data that proves this theory, they use the fact that they don't like their counselor as an excuse to want to leave. So before you jump to conclusions and go buying your loved one a plane ticket or showing up at the front door of the center merely because they didn't like the way somebody spoke to them, you need to call us first and call the agency first before you react. So yes, the relationship matters, and no, you don't pull your loved one out of treatment the second they cry foul because they didn't like the shirt somebody was wearing or the way that they were told to stay quiet during a group. So you have to be careful. I mean, the relationship matters, and you can't exclude the manipulation of the substance user and trying to use that against you. Case management. Anybody who's ever had a loved one in treatment, anybody watching this who's ever been to treatment as a primary clinician or therapist, and you probably have spoken with him or her, and of course you've always heard of their case manager. And I don't ever want to say that a case manager is the therapist assistant. They assist the therapist and the agency in the overall treatment plans and assessments for the patient that's in treatment. Case manager can do everything from helping find doctor's appointments to with sober living. Should the need arise to transfer them to a different level of care, case management is on it. I still think that case management is one of the most important jobs in treatment. They are really on the front lines with not only the clinician, but the substance user, and they're bridging everything together. And I've worked in the space quite a long time, and you couldn't do it without case management. And my hats are definitely off to them. Crisis intervention. One of the things that is, and people just heard me sigh, it's inevitable you're going to face this. Meaning, I don't care how they went to treatment. I don't care if they flew the plane themselves and they begged to go. They're going to have a moment at some point. They're going to have a meltdown. It's inevitable. I don't want to say it's normal, but it's going to happen. And that is where, if you've hired an interventionist like us, we're going to collaborate with the center and help both sides, meaning the family and the facility. If you're on your own, you're going to hope that the facility has the right crisis intervention team to defuse the situation and to block any AMAs, which is leaving against medical advice. Again, crisis intervention will happen. It is inevitable. And the stronger you're prepared as a family with boundaries, and the more you're working with your own treatment team, the better position you will be in to handle that crisis intervention. Aspects of the intervention is just recognizing the specific crisis. The biggest one we face is people who are either non-compliant or people who want to leave against medical advice. We're extremely successful in blocking those. And when I say we, I mean us and you, the family. We cannot block an AMA without you holding boundaries. It is so important for a family to understand that crisis intervention outcomes, successful ones anyway, largely in part fall on the family's ability to tell their loved one they love them and they're not supporting them acting out, and they'll have to deal with those consequences in the event that they do leave as a result of just not wanting to be there anymore. And then of course there's mental health crisis too, where 911 may have to be called, they may have to be brought to a stabilization unit. There's a lot of different crisis intervention. The point is, the agency they're in has to have policies and procedures to make sure that they're well equipped to handle any crisis that comes about. Number 9, patient education. Counselors must continue to provide information to their patients throughout the duration of treatment, both formal and informal. Processes are used to keep patients educated and up to date about treatments, discoveries, progress, and other relevant factors. You know, the more you know, the more you have at your disposal. I think that's one of the things that we lack, not we as counselors, but we as people. We're just so opinionated to give one side of things that we forget that there's other sides of things. And rather than ram one theory down one person's throat, which may be the right one, it's always good to give a menu of options on their available choices that they have. I mean, it doesn't have to be 12-step facilitation or die. It could be 12-step celebrate recovery, smart recovery. Which one do you like? It doesn't have to be you have to go to this specific doctor. You know, let's utilize your insurance. Is there one that you like? You don't have to go to this one sober living house. Here's an array of options. And again, in collaboration with your intervention team, the treatment center therapy team, we can all work together to ensure that although there is options for your loved one, we also have to remember that they're always going to default to the path of least resistance. So we want to give a menu of options, but we also want to have boundaries that they don't pick and or given the option of something that's going to be detrimental to their recovery. Referral, I like to call this the discharge planning, number 10. So basically, when somebody's done with treatment, where are they going to go? What does their aftercare look like? In some cases, the needs cannot be met by the counselor agency. And perfect example would be you're in a treatment center and now you got to leave. You've done your work and you are ready for the free world, but you're not ready to go home. So the counselor must provide relevant information and advice for the patient, meaning we suggest that you go to a sober living house and we do suggest that you not return home just yet. We do suggest that you go to a higher level of care. We do suggest that you do this, that, or the other. You can't make anybody do anything, but again, if you have a strong family support of accountability and boundaries, you'd be surprised how you have a lot more control than you think you have. I know in self-help groups like Al-Anon, they say you didn't cause it, you can't cure it, you can't control it. And I've always had a issue with the last one where I see their point completely that you can't control it directly. But trust me, I wouldn't have been doing this for 18 years if I didn't have some control over the substance user by way of boundaries and accountability and learning and families learning the word no. Because addicts and alcoholics have been controlling the family. Families letting go of being controlled makes a big difference. And as long as the substance user needs you more than you need their addiction, you have a heck of a lot of a control. If you're paying all their bills and they were living in your house, you don't have control over where they go, but you have complete control over them not coming there. So as much as I love Al-Anon, I send everybody there. I think it's a little too broad in their control thoughts, where I do believe that families have far more control than they've been led to believe. But that's just my opinion. So in regards to referrals, we believe that referrals should be made in collaboration with families who have held and learned how to set boundaries and hold their loved ones accountable, and in collaboration with the patient's treatment team that believes in not going home and extended care and sober living when, of course, the situation warrants that. The second to last one, record keeping, that's formality. Treatment centers and agencies have to keep records for several reasons. One of the ones that's important here for us is that if there is a transfer to another level of care, and of course the patient signs a release of information, it's helpful many times for those agencies to read the notes and see what has happened in the previous institutions. It's helpful sometimes for medical records. It's helpful sometimes for mental health diagnosis. The bottom line is agencies keep records and they report that data to those that are allowed to receive it. And cross consultation is the last one. What I love about this is, you know, it's about being an integrated treatment team. It's not about being a treatment team where you just treat one thing specifically and that's the end of it. Most treatment centers today are integrated, meaning they can handle just about anything under one roof. And when they can't, they're able to collaborate with other agencies to ensure that they're able to transition those clients into another level of care if need be. It's also about, you know, making sure that people's needs are met. You know, client treatment and services can benefit from in-house and outside resources. So you just want to make sure that whatever agency you're working with, they're an integrated treatment team, meaning they can do most things under one roof, but that they're also well-equipped to discharge people and or refer them out to other institutions that they're familiar with because they have a collaboration. So that is basically the overview of the 12 core functions. So what I would like people to take away from these 12 core functions is understanding that when you treat addiction, it should be looked at as a medical problem, and the amount of effort into treating drug and alcohol use should be considered as important, as in-depth as is a severe medical concern. So I hope for those of you that went through those slides with me, that you understand it's not as simple as we're going to intervene ourselves and talk our loved one to this treatment center because it looked good and they had a shiny website. You have to make sure that they're able to follow through with all of the protocols. You have to make sure that the agency or the institution is the right one for you and your loved one, just like you would do with us if you hire us for an interventionist. You have to make sure that the agency, the company, the institution, the facility has your best interest and your loved one's best interest at heart. And you want to make sure that you have a treatment team yourself, because a lot of those 12 core functions are easier said than done. You know, a lot of the addict and alcoholic's behaviors and or willingness is going to come from whether or not they have to do it. It's not whether or not they want to, it's whether they have to. And so much of the family's recovery and boundary holding and holding their loved one accountable makes the 12 core functions of the drug and alcohol counselor much easier. And it also produces far more successful outcomes than it does now.